All right, we'll get started. I know there's going to be some others joining us, but first and foremost, good evening, everyone. My name is Stacy Crawford. I'm the Director of Economic Development for the City of Mission. I'm also the project lead for the Waterfront project. As you all know, the Waterfront's really coming to life, particularly during this second round of community engagement. And we've really enjoyed the input we've received so far. Tonight really is, or this period of time, is really the best opportunity for you to help shape the vision of the Waterfront. Before I begin, though, I think it's important to acknowledge that we are on the unceded ancestral territory of the Stalo people and our municipalities on the Kwantlen, Lacamel, Matsqui, and Skalitz territories. So the whole purpose tonight is to help you understand the three land use concepts that have been introduced, as well as all of the supporting elements that are included in them. As well, we'll also go over the process and timeline for completion of the Waterfront Master Plan. And to help us with that effort tonight, it's a pleasure to introduce you to Nick Dykstra of O2 Planning and Design. He's the lead consultant for O2 Planning and Design and is representing all of the consulting teams on the side of the effort. Nick will provide us with an introduction to his team, as well as provide us with a little bit more detailed overview of the agenda. So Nick, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Stacy, and thank you to everyone that's listening in and to everyone who will listen later, and most especially to everyone that provides their feedback in the phase two engagement. At the end of this presentation, I will open up the engagement page and provide a little bit of a tutorial on how to navigate it and to try to explain all the different ways in which you can provide your feedback. For the purpose of starting the introduction of this, I'd just like to introduce that, yes, my name is Nicholas Dykstra. I'm from O2 Planning and Design, and we are a part of a very large team that was selected to do this project and to write the to craft the master plan for the area. And we are part of a large team that involves a lot of talent and a lot of expertise from the Lower Mainland and from elsewhere in Canada. And we're really leaning on a whole bunch of experience. Most of the engineering is led by Applin Martin, who is based out of Burnaby and or has a main office in Burnaby and also Vancouver and elsewhere in the Lower Mainland. We're working with Bunt on transportation elements. Brown Strachan, Pynchon, GeoPacific are also in on the team. So there's a whole suite, Bob Architects as well are helping us craft the master plan. So there's a whole suite of talent. There's really a whole bunch of really smart people and we're here to absorb what you have to tell us and to try to fit it in all with the information that we're finding in our kind of ground truthing exercises to craft the best plan that we can to allow the waterfront area to become the greatest space that it can possibly become over the coming decades. So with that, I'll move in. Here's the agenda. I'm sure you've been looking at it long enough that I don't need to read all the way through it. So I'll go right into the project status. We are in the latter half of phase two, which is developing the site concepts. We have developed these concepts. We've vetted them internally with the City of Mission, as well as landowners, council, and some major other stakeholders who have been invited. And now we're in the public engagement process. And what this whole process will result in is the development of a preferred concept that is our best effort to consolidate and to develop an understanding of the key themes and desires and to really amalgamate these with what we're finding on the ground and what our research with the market and with what's happening around to figure out how best to situate the site for future growth and to become the best waterfront that it can possibly be. We will finalize the master plan in draft form in spring and then quickly re-editing it in later also in spring to bring it to council for approval. And after that, the site gets starts to get implemented. And unique to this project, which is a really great sign, is you can already see signs of implementation on the site with the current sewer crossing across the Fraser River and the dredging that's required for that. We can see filling on some of the lands in the site, and this is essential land improvements to really catalyze the type of growth that the master plan is trying to create. So we can really, we can confidently say that the momentum is already building and the future is already taking shape, which is great news for the waterfront area. So the three concepts I will be presenting, it's important to ground them and to give you a sense of where what we've done and how we got to where we are. They all really rested upon a foundation of the council vision document that was predated our team coming on, and it really laid the terms of success, and those terms of success are very well articulated and are quite successful at making sure that everything that we do is best set up for the success of the site. And if you want to know more about those, we have downloads on the engagement site on the phase one engagement. Concurrent or directly after, perhaps with the council's vision, is the all the technical analysis that's been completed to date. The Missions waterfront site is quite complex, as I'm sure you all know. There are ground elevation changes that need to take place. There is highway, existing highway and planned highway infrastructure. There's multiple rail lines running through it. There's roadways at different grades. There's complete and incomplete sections of dike, all dike protection from the Fraser River. All of this creates a complex, but a workable technical framework from which to build the master plan on. And we are we've done a lot of work, and we continue to learn about the site. And as we develop concepts, that's how we really finish the learning. So we've done most of the technical analysis to date, and now we're in the process of proving ideas by testing them against some of the requirements to overcome the technical obstacles, figuring out conceptual ideas that can create synergies or opportunities out of elements that would otherwise be considered constraints. And then lastly, we're constantly keeping an eye on the flexibility. So all three plans will embody a degree of flexibility that allows the plan not to become a series of handcuffs if new or better ideas come along, but really the master plan becomes an infrastructure for innovation or a landing pad for investment that can attract new ideas and new ways of doing things. So I'll move on now. Went too ahead there. There's some key infrastructural or site condition information that I think we need to ground all of the work done to date and to develop some core assumptions about what the land use options are really working with in terms of what's the common ground that they're all predicated upon. So this map is about flood protection, and it's an explanation of the strategy that all of the concepts that I will introduce are rested upon. And so I'm going to go through this map kind of piece by piece, and you can follow my little mouse logo as I explain things. So the most important line on the map that we're showing right now is the solid or the thick pink line that's kind of waving along slightly inland from the Fraser River, and then it juts in here around the raceway behind Lane Creek, goes over the highway, and then up alongside the junction. This is the proposed location of the future dike. The current dike location is in the same position in a lot of cases, but the future dike will be more robust, in some locations higher, will have a stronger geotechnical structure, meaning more solid soils and more rocks and things like that to make it more robust against future river currents at high, very high flood levels. And it will be continuous from the far east side of the site to this point in the west site. And so basically the dike will be continuous up until the two points on the CPR railway mainline, in which those two locations would essentially be mild gaps because the train line is not too much lower than the ultimate dike height. But these would be mild gaps, which would need to be temporarily barriered in the event that a flood gets way, way up close to the top of the dike. The next most important color or image or tone in the map is this teal. And some of this action I previously mentioned in the fill work that's going on is already happening. And these lands that are essentially between the highway and the dike will be comprehensively filled up to or very close to flood construction level. So while we are proposing a provincially approved dike along the Fraser River, and then as we move westward along the Lane Creek edge, we are also proposing to comprehensively fill the lands between the highway and the dike. And this adds not only a second layer of rigidity and stability and resiliency behind the dike, but equally importantly allows us to create a real waterfront district where the development that's happening behind the dike isn't happening behind a wall that's much higher than it. In some cases, that would be 3 or 4 meters higher. Instead, the development is happening really in a position so the people that are walking on the sidewalks, the people that are enjoying the parks or on the streets or in the restaurants and patios can look down and see the river. They're not in between a protective wall in the river. They're really in a waterfront community. So that's a really, it's about infrastructural resiliency and planning for the best type of protection we can possibly achieve. But it's also an added benefit or an equal benefit is that it allows us to create a very easily comprehensible and very legible waterfront condition where the relationship to the river is not abstract with a barrier in between. The next most important color is the orange. Due to the fact that this area is well behind the dike and there is a filled precinct between the highway and the dike, this area we are recommending stay at the existing elevation, which is about 1.5 to 2 meters below the dike, and that this area will, because it's not protected because it's not going to be raised, it can allow a more incremental style of growth or regeneration that can uniquely kind of capture a different market segment and a different level of or pace of reinvestment. The next most important color here, or they're all more important, the last color I haven't really talked about yet is the Mission Raceway. And for the time being, the raceway will stay on the river side of the dike, similar to what it is today. And so that is important. It does allow the Mission Raceway to continue to exist on the site. And it does allow them to do improvements that are limited to the uses that they that can happen on the river side of the dike. But it is important to note that if or when in the distant future, major land use changes were to happen on that area would need to be elevated or protected sufficiently from the Fraser River with a dike and possibly fill in between the dike walls as well. What this all translates into, that was a bit of a lesson or a bit of a rambling discussion, what this really comes down to is varying degrees of complexity in terms of being able to achieve redevelopment and waterfront style development in the project area. So I'll again go through these colors. I'll start in the middle here with this purple. What the white text here is based on the names that we're calling the precincts, the different areas within the site. So Bridge East and Bridge West, because they have fairly simple land ownership parceling structure, and because the sewer crossing is seeing raising happening on the bulk of these lands currently and is ongoing work, which will be done over the winter. These lands will really be ripe and ready for redevelopment in the very short term. So this is the area that we're calling, we're labeling purple and saying that it has lower complexity and is where comprehensive development can be expected to happen in the shorter term. So in the next few years, we can start to see some serious activity on that site with vertical developments of buildings, roads, and parks, and things like that. The next least complex area is the green. So we have here, way out here in the east end, and then closer to the highway, a bit on the west end. These areas require fill, but also have less, not very complex ownership structures, and also have a lot, if not all, of public ownership in them. So out here, it's all public ownership, and then out here, it's quite a bit. So because of the lack of ownership complexities, there's also a lack of existing roadways and utilities in these areas relative to other areas in the plan. These areas, the partnerships that would be required or the ownership changes that could potentially take place to allow comprehensive investments to happen here are not that big. So these areas would be perhaps most likely for the next round of comprehensive redevelopment, or are lands that we could imagine to see changes happening directly after or shortly thereafter the purple. The next color I'd like to speak to is the yellow, and this is where we're calling in the dockside. These areas have complex ownership structures, quite a bit of existing roadway and utility infrastructure, and require significant fill. So it's not to say there isn't directly a timing requirement in what I'm telling you right now about when things can happen. If the right partnerships and investments are created quickly, any of these areas could start to see a major change in them. It's really just an accounting of the degree of complexity that the different areas contain that are must be surmounted or must be dealt with in order to see comprehensive change. So the dockside has quite a bit, and that area is basically a flag for where certain focuses should be concentrated on in order to unlock that land's future condition. The good thing about the dockside being where it is that that area already has a sufficient dike in terms of protection from the Fraser River. So in terms of the goal of creating a continuous dike, that area is already sufficient from a flood protection level. What it's missing is that district-wide raising. The station lands in here, as I mentioned before, this area would stay at its existing grades. So all that's really required for this area to start to become, for people to start seeing a lot of reinvestment in this area, is more comprehensive flood protection along the river. Once there is a very robust and successful dike, whether it's in an ultimate or an interim condition, once there is more continuous protection from the river, there will be the potential for much more significant densities and diversities of land uses to start happening in this green area and what we're calling the station lands. So it's quite different in that it doesn't require fill, but it does require offsite changes along the river to really become unlocked. And then lastly, the Mission Raceway, the blue, this area has limited redevelopment potential in its current elevation, which is proposed to remain. And that is more dedicated to the uses that the raceway would anticipate to want to see on their site. So that's the kind of flood protection strategy and the complexities that arise from it and how that impacts how we look at the land use concepts. Before I show the maps, there's a lot of pre-work here. Before I show the maps, I want to introduce the colors because they're quite colorful and the colors are really the guide or the means through which you can really understand what the maps are trying to communicate. So the colors represent a broad and flexible suite of conceptual land uses that are really what we feel are necessary to unlock the full potential of the waterfront area. These land use categories are what will direct what different types of development can go where. And the boundaries between them are a bit blurry, and I can explain that throughout the presentation as we start getting closer to the maps. And these proposed colors or land use conceptual land uses are The purple are hubs, which I'll explain all of these in the next slides. The blue is the raceway. The brown we're calling innovation, employment, light industrial. The pink we're calling industry, creative, mixed use. The red is waterfront destination. The orange is mixed use urban. The yellow is predominantly residential, and the green is open space. So what are hubs? What on earth are hubs? The purple. Hubs are really, it's because the length of the plan is multiple decades, and because it's that long, it's hard to really nail down a syncopation or a timeline of which public investments can happen where. It's better for a master plan with such a long time to be more vague on what public investment is. So the hubs are really concentrated efforts of public investment, cultural facilities, education facilities, things like that, that can be used to catalyze or can be used to create a more appealing development context. So they're clusters of public investments and uses within the same area that enable sharing of amenities and facilities through collaboration. So the proposed hubs that we're talking about here are an education hub, an innovation hub, which is really like a business incubator that's usually attached in some way to a post-secondary institution, a culture hub, which could be a small community center or a performing arts center. So there's quite a bit of range within each of these as well, a recreation hub, a civic hub, which could be anything from a small public library, a small office for public employees, whether it's or even potentially a new significant municipal building. We're not laying a claim on which of those it needs to be. We're simply creating spaces in the plan for these types of things to happen. And then something that is quite important to the plan is an integrated transit hub, a place where we can leverage the fact that there's the West Coast Express station in the site area, and we can start to think how regional bus services and city bus services interconnect along with other trails, car sharing situations, and really trying to create an intermodal section or location in the plan area that becomes really the epicenter of connectivity for the city of Mission. So here are just some examples of hubs. There's a planned integrated transit hub in Kitchener. Here's an innovation center in Salmon Arm. We're showing a picture of the Creekside Community Recreation Center. This is in Olympic Village in Vancouver, Southwest False Creek. This is a really innovative project that I'm hovering over here in Richmond. It's the Trinity Western campus combined with a city center, community center, which is all below a more dense residential development. So the other interesting thing about these hubs too is they are ideal locations for public investment, but that doesn't mean that they should not be also incorporated with private investment in a mixed use development form. And then there's also the UCB or UBC Okanagan campus in Kelowna. The next use is the raceway, we've been meeting with the raceway throughout the development of the plan, and we've been collaborating very well with them and other stakeholders to figure out how best to situate other uses around it and how to try to create synergies. And what we've been hearing from the raceway, which is quite exciting, is that they have a vision and are planning on making strategic improvements to the site that offer better service offerings for raceway fans in the ways of better facilities or improved facilities for spectating, for food and beverage, and for box seats and things like that. And these things can also be shaped in a way to try to funnel the sounds that are emanating from the raceway into a more strategic location. But equally interesting, there's also a serious strategy or an effort into diversifying the revenue streams and the service offerings that aren't necessarily all about racing, but are about other motorsports activities and other cultural events, such as bringing back large concerts, whether they be single or multi-day, to the raceway site, and which would really make Mission a weekend-long destination for many people in the region and in the province. So we're quite excited about the idea of the raceway continuing to grow and maturing into a great asset to the site, and something that we can really build off of toward creating a cluster of regional entertainment that is that is related to racing and other uses. The next land uses are the employment-related uses, so the brown and the pink. And these are really focused on maximizing the density of employment and strategically concentrating developments that have high FSR or high floor plate density relative to the size of their parcel, but also are able to contain a very diverse array of local businesses and local production companies that can really, we really want to concentrate the density of industrial activity and innovation or new innovative companies into the waterfront and provide as much as possible in terms of space for companies to grow. This doesn't mean we're showing some really great innovative examples from the Lower Mainland, and mostly in Vancouver, Richmond, and Burnaby. We're starting to see interest from the development community for multi-story industrial developments, and this is due to the acute shortage of industrial space. And we really see that this could be a great development form where the lower floors can be just like you would expect in a normal single-story tilt-up industrial development, and then lighter industrial activities can happen on the higher floors. This is an aspiration or a goal of the plan. It's not a necessity of the plan. So the plan would allow for lower densities if that's what the market prevails or market is pushing for, but it would also encourage and allow these higher forms of light industrial development. And then as we think of the pink, so the brown is really focused on the idea of multi-story or higher intensity or density of light industrial uses in terms of larger buildings. And then as we transition to the pinker colors in the plans, we're going to be thinking about having light industrial uses on the ground, but having things like offices and even housing above those. So we're quite used to the idea of having shops and restaurants below offices and shops, but we're seeing in Vancouver and other major cities throughout North America of the pressure for housing and industrial space to be really the two main drivers in most cities. And they're starting to be, every business wants to have great connectivity and offer a great great service offering to their tenants or to their employees. Oftentimes the same types of things are overlapping with residential demand. So this is a building type. This type of mixed use with industrial and office and housing above is something that's emerging, but we're really not expecting it to go away. It's going to become more and more prevalent over the coming decades. And we think that type of mixing can be really used strategically in Mission's waterfront to allow the industrial character and validity of the area to continue to live on, but to also let the area to become more intense in an urban way, allowing people to live and work in a not just industrial manners. Now, the rest will go quite a bit quicker because they're more typical. Destination Waterfront is simply a cluster of retail activities situated close to the water. These are usually done in very strategic designed experiences, similar to the examples that were showing up here with Steveston Landing, the New Westminster Waterfront which was mostly developed quite a bit ago, and then the shipyards in North Vancouver, which if you've been to is quite a special experience of public spaces and retail experiences all coming together at the waterfront in a way that really feels like a strong community space while also being a regional destination. So this is the type of thing that we're imagining for the destination waterfront. Although unique to Mission compared to these examples is that much of Mission's waterfront will be very natural feeling. It will feel like a return to the original Fraser River, and there will be a very limited instance where the urban condition of the river reaches or of the city reaches out to the waterfront. So there while there are similarities and experience that we're trying to achieve with the Mission waterfront, we're really trying to unlock the potential of the experience of Mission's waterfront being exceptional and incredibly unique in compared to the other urban waterfronts in the Lower Mainland through channeling the experience of a natural river condition. And then lastly, the orange and the yellow are things that you're quite familiar with. The orange is having shops or restaurants with housing above, and then the yellow is multifamily housing developments either in mid-rise or in higher rise form, and either all apartments or sometimes with townhomes integrated into the developments. So lastly, we have open spaces, and that we're using this right now as one category, but it is incredibly diverse within. So we have everything from urban plazas, which we're showing at the bottom in the False Creek example. We have urban playgrounds like the Pier Park example that we're showing in New Westminster. We have beautiful West Coast style beaches with logs and the rocks and the sands hitting the water. The example here is taken from Gary Point Park in Richmond. And then we have more going to that relation, that softer relationship with the river. We have more ecologically intersected open spaces that have a bit more of a landscape role, but also still have a very strong cultural role. So we're showcasing two projects here that O2 took part in Calgary. Dale Hodges Park is a stormwater filtration and a constructed wetland where we take water from kind of 1970s and 80s suburban areas that were developed below the requirements of what stormwater treatment is today in Alberta. So this park is also an infrastructural space that has core water treatment aspects and a lot of ecological capacity for biodiversity. And then on the other end of the spectrum, we're showing West Eau Claire Park here. You might be familiar with the Peace Bridge that crosses the Bow River. And this is an infrastructural project that's also a very important public open space that most people in Calgary have come to really love over the last couple of years that it's existed. The infrastructural role is that it is a key flood protection. It is the dike for the Fraser River. And the reason why it is all newly invested over there is because the grades had to go up 1 to 2 meters along the whole area. But that the presence of the dike is functionally invisible because it is overlaid with high value public spaces that offer really high quality public experiences that are really focused on cross-pollination between people that are in the space and recognition and experience of the river. So this is the full suite of options of public open spaces that we see the waterfront requiring. And we see that there is ample room for all of these, and I will go over those as well. So here we go. I've done the preamble, and here are the options. Before I dive into 1, 2, 3 as separate options, I want to just talk about what is consistent between all three, because you may notice that there are strong similarities between all three. So I just want to highlight these three zones and explain why they appear very similar in all three options. So number one, I mentioned the Mission Raceway. For the purposes of the master plan, we will bring high order servicing or like sewer and water up to the edge of the site to allow at one point in the distant future for that site to be redeveloped. And we will bring sufficient capacity to that site. But for the time being, this master plan really focuses on the raceway continuing to evolve its surface or its service offerings and trying to figure out the best way possible to use the adjacent lands to create synergies between them that create a unique destination in the Lower Mainland, a stronger one that is already there with the raceway. The next area is these areas that are hugging the highway infrastructure, and these are brown. So these are innovation employment throughout most of the or throughout all of the options, because we recognize in our market studies. I forgot to mention that City Squared is our consultant on the market studies, and we are learning very well about the acute shortage of employment lands in the Lower Mainland. And these really are lands due to their connectivity with the region and their adjacency to the highway and the railway. These are key lands to unlock to help Mission grow its employment base in the shorter term, and to help to maximize how much that can happen due to its central locations. So these lines will be fairly consistent. The edges of them will get pink sometimes, which means other uses can happen on top of that employment. But this stays fairly constant throughout the plans. And then lastly, along the river edge on the far east side of the site, previously I mentioned about the the requirement for these areas to be filled, and the varying degrees of ownership complexity and existing infrastructure requirements. Overall, in the entire plan area, this area is generally the most. It requires a significant upfront investment in order to unlock. And because of the size of that upfront investment through filling that area, it requires certain land uses and densities of higher value be developed there to maximize the recovery of those investments. But that sounds very technical and very economic. It's also a way to ensure that this portion of the waterfront, which is really the closest space between existing, the current downtown Mission, which we're showing just up here, this is the shortest route to get from downtown Mission to the waterfront area. So this is the key area where we want to concentrate the urban experience and where we want to create a fantastic waterfront urban condition along the water here, and then have downtown Mission just on the other side of the tracks, and create a really vibrant district to allow the space between, which is at the lower elevations, to grow, to thrive into an urban condition. So you can imagine that the raceways on the far west end of the site, the central areas are really focusing on maximizing employment density for the city of Mission and adding new jobs to the city. And then that still is, the employment is still a very important aspect on the east side of the plan, but it's also layered on with a very strong urban desire to develop the waterfront area into a thriving urban center. And then all along that is a core waterfront experience that is about flood protection and public value. So option one, we're calling Working River. And option one really focuses on how much, for lack of a better term, how much brown the site can contain in our suite of uses. So how much innovation, employment, and light industrial can the site encompass or can allow for? And we're using the central lands, like I mentioned before. We're also kind of exploring little peripheral areas that could see brown. We're pushing that brown color in as a buffer condition along the railway in these areas, and then we're really trying to maximize the acreage of employment that the plan area can accompany. What's really unique to this option is that, as its name suggests, there is a small inland port facility or a barge loading a piece of infrastructure that could allow industrial relationships or other economic relationships to engage directly with the river. And there's also a potential of a spur line, a railway line coming in. So there's a sense of industrial intermodality happening on the site. We think that this is a very important consideration for Mission, but it may or may not even have to happen on this site. So we know we've had meetings that have described that there's a strong desire for an intermodal connection and inland port facility, and this is only one of the possible locations. So if the question is really not, do you want an inland port facility in Mission? It's, do you want that here? Because the desire for something like that in the area exists regardless of whether it's on the site or not. And then the other kind of unique element about option one, Working River, is the distribution of public investments. So as a means to act as a buffer with the railway crossing the river, there is a large location of purple for the public investments in a large hub. We can expect a large hub to have cultural and educational, or civic and educational, like multiple hubs in one facility, and then a small hub near downtown Mission, and I can explain this one more in the next slides, because it's another constant element. And then the transit hub is always located as close as possible to the West Coast Express station. And just before I move on, I will explain something I kind of went over, which is all of the options will also show in slightly different modified locations in this general area, is what I was mentioning about how do we concentrate uses around the raceway that can work synergetically to create, or synergistically to create a a cluster of entertainment venues. And this is a casino, convention, and hotel facility, and then a marina, a large private marina, where boats can be stored, or people can arrive from downstream and to take in the offerings of this. This may seem a little isolated, but it really is only a 5-minute walk away along a beautiful waterfront park to get to that more urban area. So that is really option one, Working River. I guess the last thing I would explain about option one, Working River, is that the urban condition that connects downtown Mission to that urban waterfront condition is somewhat compressed into a single sense of corridor that would really only be felt on one or two streets. And that is that occurs by that the more traditional employment uses kind of coming in along the edge, along the railway. You'll see that start to change in the other options. So I'll move on to option two now. Option two, we're calling Downtown Focused. And the reason why it takes on that name is because the main kind of strategic move is to concentrate all future public investments as close to downtown as possible. And that is really a strategic idea to help build upon the energy of downtown and to help using public investments in culture and education and innovation as an energy to pull people across the river and then to open up the lands between those public investments and the river into as much private development as possible. So that explains kind of the thinking in this area. And we're still seeing through the pinks closer to the railway, a lot of opportunity for employment in that area, but we're starting to get a higher intensity of the urban condition on the east end of the site. The next more unique element is that we're starting to see the pink uses. So that's the mixed use office and housing above some industrial developments in the central area of the plan, and then some very generous public open spaces. So larger than absolutely necessary parks, creating some real generous waterfront open spaces with some small retail destination, retail waterfront style restaurants and such that would become a really kind of an open space based destination here that could be achieved relatively early, considering back how I spoke to the complexity and which lands we can imagine be developed first. And then the rest of the site remains the same as option one. So this is really about concentrating public investment closer to downtown and using earlier phases to achieve a higher degree of open space, public open spaces. I'll move on to option three now. Option three, we're calling multi-hub. Whereas option two concentrated public investments into one location, option three, this is more strategically thinking along the lines that the hubs will come, the funding for the hubs will come along in more separate conditions or timing, that we separate the locations of the hubs to reflect that. So I'll start where I left off in option two, whereas in option two, we were really focusing on using public open space to activate the public value of the earlier lands that could be developed. In option three, we're seeking the greatest amount of diversity. So we have innovation, employment, and light industrial at the top. We have industry creative mixed use. We have destination retail, and we have a public hub, something like a satellite location for a post-secondary institution or an innovation hub. All of that along a beautiful waterfront park, which I will go into some of the elements we can expect along there shortly. And then as we move into the east side of the site, we're really maximizing the urban condition, similar to the last option. So in effect, multi-hub seeks to dissipate and pull, or stretch, I should say, not dissipate, stretch that urban condition as far west as we can, understanding the sensitivities of the sound and the activities that happen on the raceway but trying to pull that urban experience as far west as we can to really create a unified urban waterfront sensation. And we can imagine in all of these options, as you're standing on the Matsqui Park side, differing types of, you know, imagine just after sunset, you've watched the sunset in Matsqui, and you're looking across at Mission and you're seeing what type of skyline and what type of shimmering city you're seeing. So in option three, you have the kind of most direct interface with a beautiful park and then the shiny buildings and lights behind. Option two, you have a bit of a gap here with the large open spaces. And then option one, I should go back as I'm saying that. Option two, you have a bit of the gap with the public open spaces. And then option one, you have that more industrial feel in the middle with but that urban condition always being along the edges. I mentioned before that there's a lot of diversity to the open spaces. And next I will, here's a kind of overall map that can't possibly be understood at this scale. And that's just because there is so much going on and there's the potential for so much to happen in the public open spaces that are possible to achieve in the waterfront area. So the next few slides, I will just walk you through from west to east. To give you a sense of the diversity of offerings that could be achieved at a conceptual level. A lot of the elements that I will talk about can be moved around in the plan. They don't necessarily need to be shown where they are, but generally we're placing them in the kind of general vicinity in the plan area of where we think they make most sense from a technical perspective, from a social and economic perspective, and also from an Indigenous perspective. We have met a few times with local First Nations representatives, and it's through the open space. It's not just through the open space, but it's really it's an important facet for us to get right is to how we to look at how we renaturalize and respect the fish habitat capacity for the shoreline in this area is an important element in how the Mission waterfront area can be used as a project of reconciliation. So I'll start again here from the west. So on the very west end, this is between the CPR mainline and the Mission Raceway. We all know this right now is a bit of a hard to get to, a bit of a no man's land, which attracts some kind of activities that are antisocial to say, or some people are doing things there that they're looking to not be found. So what we're really most excited about this site is its inherent natural beauty and also its inherent stormwater functionality and ecological biodiversity. And so what we're most excited about achieving in this area is really opening up public access to it. And this can be achieved through a series of trails. Most importantly, the Experience the Fraser Trail, which could in the earlier phases due to some district-wide infrastructure work that is planned in the next couple of years, we can imagine a trail along the north side of the raceway site, bringing public access all the way west, much further west, a few kilometers, bringing the public into this area. And then as development occurs, a series of boardwalks, a series of pathways, similar to the project that I showed in Calgary, where interpretive placards and where a nature walks can be opened up, and there can be loops in here, a place where classrooms can be brought down to understand how the tributaries meet the Fraser River, how fish habitat it can be managed and constructed to best think of the health of the species and the biodiversity of that ecosystem, and how such natural and lush conditions can be so present, so close to the center of our cities. This is a really high value place for more contemplative experiences, more educational experiences, and very quiet, pleasant experiences. I'll move east now. So now we're out of the Lane Creek area and we're on the proper waterfront along the Fraser River, just at the very east edge of the raceway. And this is that area where we're talking about that casino, convention, hotel, and large public marina, or I should say a potential large public marina. We haven't done too much research into the potential approvability from a provincial perspective, but this is something that we're hearing from some of our most important stakeholders as a great idea, and we really do think there are some strong synergies with that. So I'll just start from the west edge here of the waterfront, and I'll start describing the ideas as we move eastward. So we're starting with a new large high quality public boat launch. This may not be the exact location. There are certain synergies for why we're showing it here, but there are also synergies elsewhere. But this would be a boat launch for private watercraft to essentially be replacing the one at the current harbor. We know it's too steep for trailers and trucks, and there's not an adequate amount of parking around there. So we think that that is a really strong program need and a strong potential in this general vicinity of the plan area to achieve a very robust and high quality public boat launch with adequate parking facilities, with adequate trailer storage areas, and a great mooring dock to you know, provide that whole servicing experience. Once we start going inland from that, we start going into a very different condition along the Fraser River shoreline that is currently exists. So right now, generally the shoreline is quite steep, where the land kind of gets up close to the river and then the shoreline cuts down to the water, and then sometimes there's some seasonal beaches down there. The future dike will be built well back from the existing shoreline, and what that will allow us to do is have a low slope relationship with the Fraser River. And what that allows the designers and us to do is to work with local First Nations to get as much experience and knowledge about fish habitat as we can, and to really design a strong relationship between the seasonality of the river and the species of plants and the conditions of rocks in there to create a renaturalized and ecologically valuable and dynamic river experience. So we would imagine a nice public promenade along the top of dike, and then a series of strategically located narrower public pathways that are taking people through this more ecologically sensitive and dynamic open space experience. When moving east, when we get to the space underneath the Abbotsford Mission Highway Bridge, I'm sure you've all noticed when you've been walking your dogs how beautiful the bridge is underneath. The columns looking over to the Matsqui side have a really nice elegance to them, and the height of the bridge deck above is quite beautifully high. It doesn't feel like you're compressed under the bridge at all. It feels almost feels very large and generous. So we think this is a great area to provide a really unique public open space that focuses on rain protected active sport activities. So things like climbing walls on the bridge abutments, basketball courts, volleyball courts, skate park, these types of urban activities that can best kind of encapsulate the experience or the potential that this space provides, all while giving really exceptional views that are unique to this bridge, to this city, to this particular site. So this is really a place-based park, to use some planner jargon, which means this park can only exist here and is really something special for the city of Mission, and something that becomes something that everybody knows about. People are often taking selfies or pictures. It's a highly Instagrammable experience. That sounds so superficial, but it's true. Moving east from the bridge, the Under the Bridge Sports Park is a whole suite of open spaces. So on the river side of the dike, the existing grades allow for a very large, very expansive, very generous public beach, similar to the Gary Point example that I showed earlier. So this is something that we would like to really double down on and provide really a Mission Central beach that's mirrored with the Matsqui beach on the other side. So we can imagine, especially with the bike paths on both sides of the Abbotsford Mission Highway Bridge that we're proposing, that there can be really a synergy between both the parks on both sides. And one could even experience both in the same day or the evening. And there can be this kind of reciprocity between the two. moving east from that, we go back to that fish habitat, that really lush and well-considered ecological zone. And then a little east of that, this, and by the way, this is another potential location for a boat launch here because of the idea of putting a parking lot underneath the hydro lines. But this could be another off-leash area, so a small beach specific to people allowing their dogs to be off-leash. We know that that's where a lot of you, how a lot of you currently experience the site, and we understand that, that there is a lot of value to that, and dog ownership over the last 2 years has gone up quite a bit. So there's a lot of cultural value to providing a safe and enjoyable space for that in the Mission Waterfront area. Unique to option two, which is why we have the two logo in here, are these two more generous open spaces. These are very flexible. They could be developed. So we're showing that the west side one gets developed as a synergy, in synergy with the Under the Bridge Sports Park to add more sport active lifestyle amenities into this area. I will note that these are not regulation size soccer fields. These are urban format fields. So this is more for pickup games and not necessarily league games. And then the but that could change. It could be any sort of other activity depending on what we hear from you, if this is a preferred location for open spaces. And then the other one is really more flexible, and it's about celebration, it's about festivals, and really all of the waterfront park can be seen as this linear space of celebration, of interpretation, of Indigenous education, and of regrounding what it means to be a waterfront city and mission. So now I'll move over the bridge, the railway bridge, into what we're already quite familiar with as a as what Mission's waterfront is as a public experience today. So we're calling this the Harbor Promenade with the viewing deck. There is the foundations for a viewing deck right here that just were, it was never completed upon the initial construction. So we would propose that that be completed. We would propose that the harbor be improved and you know maintained to continue to provide the excellent service. And if the commercial commercial operations, which are run by the federal government, cease to exist at any point, we're not saying it has to, but if it does, that it would be maintained in place by the city and turned into a public marina or continue to have public access of the sort. We think not necessarily here, but somewhere along the waterfront, there's would be a high potential for a float plane dock. So some air service could be run to other lakes in the area or to other destinations. And then that the existing boat launch be repurposed for smaller watercraft. Because this area is really envisioned to take on more of an urban character, this would be a low parking lot demand boat launch. So things like kayaks, paddle boards, canoes, things like that. Not boats that require a big trailer, which would go at the larger public boat dock that I previously mentioned. So this area really is about, we're getting into that more dense urban experience. And you can start to see that we're mentioning shops and restaurants starting to be directly back behind the waterfront. And keep in mind that right now, the experience along the dike here is that Harbor Avenue is very, very low and the dike is very high. We would be filling this entire area up right to the top of dike. So when you're on Harbor Avenue, you're looking down at the river. When you're in these restaurants, you're looking across and seeing water, not a rock wall. So the epicenter of the waterfront area is really this very constrained and very modest sized moment where the naturalization of the entire waterfront experience takes a breath and the city perches over. So similar to the examples that we shared with Steveston and North Vancouver and New Westminster, this is where the urban condition comes over and perches up to like a sheet wall condition where one can stand in a plaza where there would be a small structure for a farmer's market or for some cultural performances, some play structures and fountains. Someone can enjoy a coffee or an ice cream and then look down all the way down on either side of this beautiful naturalized Fraser River waterfront. And this would be really connected to the location and all of the options where that key destination retail experience would be. So the urban condition here would take you from the edge of the river and start to pull you into the city and along one of these major routes, which depends on what the final highway configuration is, to bringing you into downtown Mission across the railway tracks. Very importantly to this idea is that immediately to the east, the dike pulls back in from its perched out location. It pulls back in into that low slope, well recessed area, and there is a large central public beach. So you can imagine, you know, having your coffee on a, or your cold drink that you got from the market on a hot day, and looking over the ledge here and seeing a whole bunch of people enjoying the waterfront, similar to what you see in many other cities. Not necessarily, you know, many people may not be comfortable with dipping their toes in the water, and that's not necessarily what it has to be for all people. This is really a generous public open space that's much closer to the water than many are used to seeing in the urban waterfronts of the Lower Mainland. And then just to the east and inland of that, option unique to option 1 and 3 is a more local open space here that we think is a great location for a destination playground and an opportunity to celebrate the industrial heritage and the cedar shake heritage of the area through the repurposing of some of the large machines that are associated with those activities and using them as large sculptural pieces. And that can also be a theme throughout the rest of the waterfront. It's important to remember what was and what kind of brought us here, and those are projects that we've seen around the world have been very successful at memorializing large industrial machinery through ways that kind of take out its danger and monumentalize its scale and put public uses in and around, allowing people to get much closer to the things that they're very familiar with at a distance, but in a safe and enjoyable manner. So this public open space is unique to option 1 and 3. As we move eastward, we enter into that fish habitat, that really naturalized river condition again, and then the intensity, the public programming intensity of the open space starts to pull away, and it starts to, as we reach the east edge of the site, it starts to be very flexible and very natural. So there's a syncopation between that lush river edge with the fish habitat considerations with small beaches, and then the dike gets right up close to the railway, and the experience, the Fraser Trail, then goes along the water between the river and the railway, further east, eventually all the way to Hatsik. And the long-term goal is that this trail becomes something that takes people all the way from Agassiz to Vancouver. And we think it's really important that Mission, the city of Mission, do what it can to achieve its segment as early as possible, because it is a beautiful idea that's been achieved elsewhere and really ties the cultural value of the river through an entire region very, very well. The last space I want to talk about is not along the Fraser River, but it's in the most urban space. So a public open space that can help tie downtown into the waterfront area. And this is not only a public open space, but it's also a new piece of public infrastructure in the form of a kind of a showcase pedestrian bridge. So currently, well, we all know that the center ice of downtown Mission is at Welton and First Avenue, right at the corner where the old post office is. And that is really the departure point. We know that to get into the waterfront area right now, you have to keep going east to Murray Street, and that will remain. That connection will stay in place. But what we think is the strongest opportunity and the most kind of potent point of energy to tap into to connect downtown Mission to the waterfront is at that corner. So what we're proposing And it doesn't necessarily need to be built in the earliest phases, but it should be considered something that's very catalytic in unlocking the potential of these areas, is a signature pedestrian bridge that can start just south of First Avenue on Welton before the street really drops down. And then while the street would still drop down, but probably be closed to cars as a full connecting street, maybe there can be some parking at the bottom end of it. There's a pedestrian bridge that raises up ever so slightly, something that a cyclist would feel very comfortable with, or someone on a wheelchair would feel very safe and comfortable navigating a slight upward incline. And that upward incline is to ensure that the bridge clears North Railway Avenue and then clears over the CPR main line and the West Coast Express line. And then at that moment, there's this critical moment of clarity, of uniform experience, where one can look back and look north and see the museum up the hill, can see the post office, can see downtown Mission that they've just left. They can look down and see the CPR main line, the West Coast Express station, and can actually even see Lane Creek. And then as the bridge kinks and takes on a new direction, they can see down Mershon, and in the far distance, they're perfectly aligned with Mount Baker. So this is really, they can see the Fraser River as well. This is really a moment where the whole idea of Mission as a waterfront city and the transition from downtown into the waterfront area is most clear. And that is the departure, the almost the procession of taking oneself from downtown Mission into the waterfront area. So we would propose that that bridge kink down to align with Mershon and then land, continue to descend at that same kind of safe and accessible slope into a series of public open spaces that are fronted by a mix of public and private developments. And this is the kind of central plaza for the waterfront area. It's very urban, while it's also connected to natural conditions with the creek, the existing creeks that kind of reach inland into the site. And this is really that spot of hyperconnectivity that I was mentioning earlier. This is where the regional connectivity of transit can happen. This is where there are public investments. This is where there are higher density private investments. And this is where it all culminates into a public space that links to downtown. So we think this general type of configuration was in all of the options, because we think it is really an essential idea to create that meaningful connection, and to do so at a human scale and not adding another road bridge to link downtown and the waterfront. So that's the whole suite of open spaces. And I should mention that none of the ideas are really set in stone yet. So through your feedback, we've created these ideas both in the open spaces and in the land use options to spark the conversation. The goal is not to choose one of the land use options, or not to just select the majority of the open spaces. These are just really conversation starters. And then all the feedback that we hear from you in the survey and in the mapping comments, we will incorporate, and we will work with the City of Mission Council, the stakeholders, and get their input and try to create a bit of a best hits preferred option that seeks to really speak to and achieve the key themes that we hear from all of your inputs. So the next steps from this public engagement session is to finalize the plan. So we will develop that preferred concept before the end of the year. And then early in the year through winter, we'll work really hard to overcome and to create technical solutions to make that happen, and to create roadmaps towards success with a level of preliminary design that instills a lot of confidence, that instills market confidence, and creates the type of groundwork to create a public expectation and a market expectation that this is going to happen. So that's the goal of the master plan, and the timing of it is coming along quick. It's coinciding with the raising of the lands on the other side of the Abbotsford Mission Highway Bridge. And like I said, there's this momentum right now that's quite exciting. So we're really excited to hear from you all on what your ideas are. And then we're even more excited to take those ideas and to try to develop the final master plan and get it approved and see the area transform. So right now I'm going to go over all the options and all the opportunities to provide feedback in at the engagemission.ca website. So I'll drag it over right now so we can go over it together and you can see what's there. So if you go to engage.mission.ca, here, I'll go back to the full homepage here. Just scroll down and you'll see the mission waterfront. You select that and you're at now, you're at the Waterfront Revitalization Master Plan homepage. Within there, due to the kind of varying levels of comfort with technical streams and us always trying to innovate and how people can provide feedback, there are multiple ways. Some people only have a few minutes. Some people have a lot of time. Some people aren't comfortable or confident with electronic means. Some people are very, and we've tried to create a suite of options that allows differing levels of comfort and confidence to provide feedback in many forms. So I'll go through a few of those right now. If you only have a few minutes and you want to get your core inputs down, we have part one master plan components. So we call this the quick participation. If you only have a few minutes, click this one and it's the first survey and it's kind of gets your take on some key themes. If you've got a bit more time, you should do this one as well as part two, the land use scenarios. Those really go through the maps and ask you some key questions about each map. And if you want to give your feedback on the public open spaces proposed, and if you have time and comfort to do that, then I'll just choose this one as an example. So you go in here and you see how it's divided into different parts, and you can start that survey. And we go through all of the, you know, we describe all of these different spaces. We show beautiful precedent pictures of the types of spaces that we're thinking of. And then we ask you some questions about which ones are most important to you. So it's critical that we can get as much feedback as we can so we can know what elements are most important to all of you and develop some key themes and some key tendencies that can allow us to understand what should be incorporated in the final master plan. And then unique to this project, and this is more of an emerging technology, so it is kind of beta. You don't need to do it, but if you're comfortable with it, we have an interactive map program or a piece of software. And I'll be frank, this is developed by some very nerdy individuals, many of whom I work with, the types of people that do this. And we apologize for, there's a bit of a unintuitive elements to this. We're latching onto a larger piece of software here, and we've provided feedback to them about how to improve it, but it can't happen fast enough for us to be able to convey it and fix the problem. So what you need to do on this one is just, you know, read the directions as you go through. It explains kind of the theme of the activity. But the most important thing is you have to hit this close button. You can't just click elsewhere on the screen like you should be able to. So you have to hit that close button. And what you have here now is a whole map of Mission and focused in on the waterfront area and some options over here. So what we can do here is turn on each of the options. We can oscillate between option 1, 2, and 3 or the open space plan. And then what we can do within each of those is you can provide different comments. Like if it's a positive comment or if it's a concern, you can, for example, say, I'm not sure about this here. So we can submit that right there. And then we on the consulting team will see how many comments, positive or negative, go into there, and we'll read each of them and to get a general sense about the level of comfort about some of the ideas that are supported. Similarly, we can also say, you can also give area-based comments. So here, this one, I chose a positive comment just to kind of show balance. And someone could say, I love the idea of shops here. Oh, let's put an exclamation mark because they love it. So then that goes back to us and we can see all that. And you can do that independently. When I turn on option three, those comments go away because those were specifically associated with the open space. So we can, from our end, we can really nail down what comment was related to what option and what theme, and we can really create a whole kind of data environment from your feedback and best understand a collective patterns and themes that come out of it. So that's the suite of offerings, the core suite of offerings that are available, the three surveys and the interactive map. And then tonight we're taking part in the webinar. And very importantly, I need to make a huge plug for an open house. We're all going to be at the Heritage Park Middle School next Monday from 6 to 8 p.m. And we're going to be there with big poster boards, and you can talk to us in person and we can talk about your ideas. You can put down post-it notes. So if all of the other stuff, the surveys and the maps are insufficient and you're not satisfied with that, we are coming to town and we'll be all ears, and we'll also be there to help explain anything that that is unclear. So there's lots of opportunities to provide feedback, and that's because we really want to hear it, and we really want to we really look forward to incorporating it as best we can into a plan that the most people can feel heard and feel that their dreams or aspirations for the area are spoken to, and also that really untaps all of the economic, the social, the indigenous, the cultural potential of the site to become something very special, a very unique offering out of all the cities in the Lower Mainland that have a relationship with the Fraser River. We really think Mission has the opportunity to become really that best in class, a waterfront community that speaks really to that contemporary issues of flood resiliency, of ecological integrity, of reconciliation, and of a new type of urban condition and industrial condition with the river. So thank you very much. And I'll hand it back to Stacy to say some closing words. And I hope to see you all on Monday, and I can't wait to start reading all your feedback.
Thanks so much. That was a great overview of the master planning process. As everyone can see, it's obviously a very complex and challenging area to plan for, but it's also incredibly exciting to see the potential come to life. We know this is a lot of information to absorb, but I do hope you have a much better understanding of the progress that's been made to date. And with that understanding, I want to make sure that you are clear that we definitely want to hear from you on what you liked or perhaps what you felt could be improved upon. And of course, the best way to do that is by completing the surveys as well. We encourage you to share this. We want to make sure we get as much input as we can. This is presentation has been recorded as well. So make your friends and family aware they can have a look at this and go through it at their own at a time that makes sense best for them. In addition to that, of course, our waterfront office is also open and available for further discussion if you like. And as Nick mentioned, we'd love to see you on Monday evening as well. So thank you once again for your valuable time, and good night, everyone.